What's up, guys? My name is still David Pere, and in this video, we are going to discuss how to operate your short-term rental business. So before arrival, guest interaction is huge. In fact, if you are unable to respond quickly to messages, then you need to look into a platform like SmartBnB in order to automate messaging as much as possible. Respond quickly. I cannot tell you how important this is. If you fail to respond to messages quickly, they will book with somebody who does. When I first started hosting for Airbnb, there were several times that the potential guest had already booked with somebody else by the time I responded. I have also had people book with me, and one of the first things they said is, "Thank you for getting back to me so quickly." And to me, that basically says that I got the listing before somebody else just because I responded quickly. So make sure you can respond. Now, I work in a secure vault, so there are no cell phones allowed inside. I now make a conscious effort to check my phone every hour or two just to ensure that I'm not missing potential bookings. Systems are the name of the game in efficiency, and I have a rule of thumb that if I find myself sending an email for the second time, I give it a template in my Google Drive. Similarly, if I have to answer the same question more than once in Airbnb or VRBO, I save it as a messaging template. Remember the welcome message in my previous video with directions to my house? That was the first messaging template that I ever created. Now, SmartBnB allows you to fully automate messaging and even has artificial intelligence to answer new questions without needing your assistance. I will definitely utilize SmartBnB when I go to begin listing more than one listing. I'll post a link down below and you can give them a 14-day free trial. Maybe you like them. Guest interaction during their stay will vary based on your personality and the type of short-term rental you're hosting. For example, I would not expect you to greet your guest at the home if you don't live there, but some people do anyway. Sometimes I greet my guests upon arrival. Other times I just stay out of their way, unless we cross paths in the kitchen. And for me, that really just depends on the vibe I get from them while messaging. Some guests really enjoy talking to the local host and getting the inside scoop about what to do in the area, while other guests would prefer to just smash the like button. No, just kidding. Other guests would prefer not to even see you. So feel your guest out and interact as much as you and your guest are comfortable with. Ultimately, you want your guests to feel as welcome and at home as humanly possible. So live by the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you, and focus on being a good person. If you do these two things, I'm confident that your guest interaction will be top notch. Everybody wants to know about getting 5-star reviews. 5-star reviews are extremely important to the success of your listing, and for that reason, you should go the extra mile to earn one, even when it isn't convenient. For example, I mentioned above that I had a guest book a stay at the house that ended on a date I thought had been blocked off. That guest was going to check out after I had already left on a flight, and I wasn't going to be home in time to clean prior to the next guest arriving. I explained to them what had happened and asked if he would be okay staying in the upstairs bedroom, which only has my kid's twin mattress on the floor, as opposed to the queen bed downstairs. And I explained the reason behind this, I was very open about it, and that I wouldn't have time to clean the queen bed after he left. Luckily, he was cool with this and pretty understanding. Understandably, this was not the way I wanted this listing to start off. To ensure I got a decent review, I left him a thank you card with $20 inside of it when I left that morning. That 20% discount was like icing on the cake that allowed me to keep my perfect 5-star record, and it's still better than not having any income at all for those 2 days. Now remember, in the short-term rental hosting business, when arguments and issues arise, it is always better to be kind and helpful than to be right. You want to be an unforgettable host. Every guest will have a different perception of what the perfect host looks like, so put your best networking skills to work. Build rapport with your guests by finding common ground to talk about. That could be as simple as the clothes they are wearing, electronics they're using, or it could come from conversations. Maybe you've been to the city they came from. Whatever it is, just find something in common with your guests and make light conversations with them about it. You need to match and mirror your guests by subtly mimicking their gestures while talking. If they fold their arms, subtly do the same within 30 seconds after noticing it. That will subconsciously help them to like you more. Don't get too crazy with this, because if they're like, you know, they fold their arms and you're just like, you know, it gets weird, so don't be weird. Now, I say to be a good person all the time because it's so important, but put your needs aside and focus on being nice towards your guests no matter what. So here are a few ideas of things that you can set out for your guests upon their arrival in order to start their visit on a good note. You could put out snacks and a nice note. Maybe you put out some chocolate. You could put out a bottle of cheap wine. You could give them a Metro card if you're somewhere like DC. Give them a map of the area. You could also ask your guest to have breakfast or a meal with you. A little bit goes a long way in terms of keeping your guest happy. They don't necessarily expect all of this, so just be nice and go a little bit out of the way. All of the above advice is great, but it doesn't negate the fact that Airbnb requires more than a traditional long-term rental does to mitigate the workload. You need to have systems in order to streamline the operations as much as possible. Being an Airbnb host is completely manageable in your spare time, but you need to prepare ahead of time for the worst case scenarios. So you need to be proactive, vice reactive, as the military says. If you have a third-party website that you use for booking, have your friends leave some great reviews about you starting out. Even if they didn't stay with you, it will build credibility for people on your site, and then as you get more authentic reviews, replace the original one. You need to work with the rule of three. One is none, two is one. Have extra sets of bedding and towels on hand. I have a washer-dryer on site, and I still maintain two sets of bedding for each bed, as well as two sets of towels for every guest. If you do not have a washer and dryer on site, I would recommend that you maintain three sets of everything. That way you have one for use, one for backup, and one can still be at the cleaners or on standby. No matter what, you always wanna have a clean backup set of sheets and bedding, just in case you never know. In preparation for your guest's arrival, ensure the listing is clean, including shared spaces, illuminated, and smells good. The first things your guests will notice are how the listing looks and smells, so make sure you have candles or Febreze on hand to freshen up the area. If you're going to lay out a snack, bottle of wine, note, or some other gift for your guests, make sure you've done it prior to them arriving and not just like, oh shoot, I forgot, here you go. Verify once again that you sent the welcome message and directions to your guests in order to avoid confusion. Do not forget to lay out your guest book either. I'm gonna put a link below for a kit that I use to prep my listing, so you'll be able to see all the supplies and stuff that I use and take a look at it. So I don't use professional cleaning services yet for my Airbnb. I just haven't needed to because my checkout and check-in times are set around my work schedule, so I have time to clean in the interim. I charge a cleaning fee nonetheless, which is great because I'm effectively paying myself to clean the listing or for the supplies. I haven't found the magic wand that allows me to find a great cleaner yet, but I'm still looking. I've had some luck finding affordable cleaners through Craigslist, but they weren't extremely reliable. On the other hand, finding professional cleaners online isn't difficult, but they're not cheap enough for me because I'm not trying to charge a $100 cleaning fee when I can do it myself. Another option could be a service like Turnover B&B, which is a website that syncs to your calendar and automatically schedules cleaning for your guest checkout window. I haven't used them yet because the cleaners they recommend were much more expensive in my area for just me cleaning a room. Would have been good for a whole house. But that being said, if I was renting the entire home, those prices were pretty reasonable. So if you have time to clean your place, it's a great way to make some extra money for every listing and simultaneously cut your expenses. But if not, maybe you check out Turnover B&B, or maybe you just find a cleaner on Craigslist, but some way to keep your place clean. You need to create systems as quickly as possible in order to streamline your Airbnb hosting adventure. The first thing you need to do is set up the booking settings in order to ensure there is time for you to complete turnover between stays. In the military, every billet has a turnover binder, and this binder is meant, and they would be able to execute the job correctly with only the guide as a reference. Now, you don't necessarily need to create a turnover binder for yourself, but document what you're doing well. That way, you can use it as a training material for an assistant one day if you bring somebody in. You should probably create checklists for repetitive tasks. Airline pilots use a checklist for everything they do. This ensures there'll be no overlooked steps in their processes, and I definitely think that's important. I have a checklist for every time I do a podcast recording, every time I start a YouTube video, I used it for this video, and many other things that really seem simple. In fact, I'm creating a checklist for turnovers. You would be amazed at how many times that checklist has saved me from recording without turning on my external audio microphone. Every single month, you will feel a new friction point or think of another way to streamline things. When that happens, put it into place immediately. Don't put off an hour of work now if it'll save you a half hour every month going forward. The ability to systemize will save you a lot of time going forward in life. So create systems. You should label everything. Labels are just absolutely wonderful. I use them for my listing, my laundry room, organization, cleaning supplies, which remote control goes to which device, even for the little changer I got to allow you to toggle between DVD, Xbox, and N64, it's got labels on it. You could even go so far as to label the drawers and cabinets in the kitchen so that people know where everything is. The beauty to labels is that they will answer your guest questions even when you're unavailable to do so. Now, communication is a huge. You need to systemize messaging as much as possible to ensure that guests don't get lost or confused during check-in. A good rule of thumb is to create a template anytime you send a message more than once. If, for example, your guest asks about the parking situation and you've gotten the same question before, just create a template that answers that question. That way, when you get asked about it in the future, you already have the template and you can just copy paste. As mentioned before, communication is the most important thing for you to do prior to your guest's arrival. It is critical that you are able to communicate quickly and accurately in order to make their check-in as smooth as possible. There are a few things that Airbnb expects their host to provide for their guests. These include safety, security, and reliability. If you adhere to these guidelines, you will be well on your way to superhost status. All of these can be boiled down to my favorite phrase, be a good person. But for safety, don't harm yourself or others. Don't threaten anyone. You shouldn't be creating hazardous situations for people. Make sure your place is safe. Keep a first aid kit on hand. Keep a fire extinguisher on hand. Maintain a functioning smoke detector and carbon monoxide detectors, and ensure that your property meets government safety guidelines. Make sure the listing is safe for children, or declare that children are not welcome. For security, there should be no theft, vandalism, or extortion. No spam, phishing, or fraud. Don't violate others' privacy or intellectual property rights. You must disclose cameras, and they cannot be in private areas like bedrooms and bathrooms. So I have one on my refrigerator, but it's clearly disclosed, and if a guest asks nicely, I'll let him turn it off. Fairness. Absolutely no discriminatory behavior or hate speech. In the blog post, I share a link to an article where this lady was super discriminatory, and it's terrible. Like, don't be that way. No bullying or harassing others. Don't disturb the surrounding community, and just be a good person. Authenticity. No misrepresenting yourself. Don't misrepresent your spaces. As I've mentioned in previous videos, everything you have should be an accurate representation of what you said on your Airbnb. Don't treat experiences as just a transaction, but as a place for others to belong. Now, for reliability, you need to provide inhabitable spaces, clean, maintained, and with all other necessary utilities. You don't cancel on your guests. Respond to messages from your guests, so communicate. Consistently low ratings can result in your listing being removed, and as you've heard me say a million times, just be a good person.